Library. And when I did that, I was not aware that it was actually the 75th anniversary of the opening of this building. On May 3rd, 1937, the historic Knight Library opened to the public. Actual heart of the campus community. And it also still stands as a monument to the Depression era and the people who built this structure. And it is also one of the finest examples in the Northwest, if not the best, of the integrated art and architecture that existed in public works, federally funded, prior to World War II, when that kind of program went out of favor. And so today, we're going to take a virtual tour of the library and the artists and artisans who created it. And we're largely going back in time to 1937. Strategic planning for a new library began not long after the first library on campus, now Fenton Hall, opened in 1907. The head librarian, Matthew Douglas, who started in 1908, had already succeeded in getting an addition to the building in 1914. An attempt to get state funding for a new library was vetoed in 1926 by the governor. And so we have a history here of lack of state funding. Douglas continued to work with Ellis Lawrence, the campus architect, the university president, and faculty to create a variety of plans that might match funding opportunities that would occur. Lawrence was a Portland architect who was first hired by the state to design a campus plan for the growing University of Oregon. And his original plan we see here was in the Beaux-Arts tradition of symmetries and grand scale. Actually, this tiny part right here is part of Condon Hall, and here we see the existing structures. So it was an enormous scheme that could never possibly be fulfilled. And a characteristic of this design was that a large auditorium was the centerpiece. Lawrence headed the new School of Architecture, and he served as the campus architect. And so until his death, until 1946, he designed most of the buildings, if not all, on this campus. Thanks to the Great Depression, the prospects of funding the new library became more possible. With the advent of federal programs designed to employ people with large public works projects. In 1933, Lawrence came up with a new plan. This would be one of 25 schemes that his firm would design. And at that time, President Arnold Bennett Hall decided that the library would be the center of the campus, not the auditorium. And we see Lawrence's original plan or the scheme similar to Cizalla Library in the University of Washington, the kind of collegiate Gothic that was popular at the time. In 1933, the State Board of Education applied for a loan from the Public Works Administration to fund a new library, and in 1935, an allotment was granted. In addition to about $450,000 that eventually came from PWA funds, there were funds from the Alumni Holding Company, which was the equivalent, I imagine, of today's foundation, from students and other donors. Images of the latest iteration of the library started appearing in 1935. And at this time, the building started assuming more classical features. And you notice, to save money, the second story of the wings was eliminated. In Groundbreaking for this new building took place in September 1935. While the PWA funded the construction of the building, it only partially funded the interior and the artworks. The WPA funded the wages of those people, but any materials used had to come from other sources. And so when we speak of WPA art, that's somewhat misleading. It's more appropriate to call this New Deal art because the variety of funding sources involved, including gifts and donations. The UO was very much advantaged in getting funding from the Works Progress Administration for Art because the head of the state program, which is called the Oregon Art Project, each state had its own program, was Burt Brown Barker. Barker was the vice president of UO. He was a wealthy individual who only took a dollar a year's salary. And he was a patron of the arts. And he's best known today probably because he's the one who commissioned and had donated to the university the sculpture, the Pioneer Mother, which was installed in 1932 and is modeled after his own mother. Building the library started in November 1935. A student named Gordon Gilkey was hired to create a series of etchings that depicted the construction. And for this effort, Gilkey was the first student to get a Master of Fine Arts degree. Gilkey would later become liberal arts at Oregon State University, and a renowned printmaker and a print collector. And these etchings you can see today in the Rowe Conference Room. Among the faculty who were hired to work on the new building was Brownell Fraser. Brownell Fraser was a student at the university. She graduated from AAA in 1921 and began employment in 1931 as the first interior design instructor. And this would be the courtyard of AAA that she would see in her time. And incidentally, in I guess the 1980s, some students of Fraser found in a Seattle art gallery a portrait of her, which they done by Ann McCosh in 1940, and they bought it and gave it to the AAA library where it is today. The purpose of the browsing room was quite innovative and garnered much attention at the time. And this is a picture from about 1938 or 39. The room was specifically designed for recreational reading and relaxation. And it occupied the most prominent location in this building. Its use for studying was outright discouraged. And supposedly there was a sign to that effect. Among its collections were the Homer collection of beautiful books, which still exist, an art books collection, and something called a house collection. And the house collection provided titles that sorority and fraternity houses could select from to take to their own house libraries to be checked out. And so an traveling collection exchange took place. And in charge of the reading room, a librarian was hired to manage this service. Her name is Ethel Sawyer, and she was a former employee of the Multnomah Public Library System. Here we see in greater detail the original decorations of the room designed by Fraser, such as the light fixtures, which are, well, she didn't design these, but the light, the lamps, which are still here, the draperies, furniture, and the carpets, which you see formerly had fringe on them. These three rugs were actually handmade, hand-woven in northern China. And they didn't reach this library until 1938 because of the war between China and Japan and customs issues. The principal wall objects in this room, cedar wood carvings, 5 by 7 feet each, designed by artist Phyllis Muirden, who is a Portland high school art teacher. And they're entitled Apollo and Diana the Huntress, although some call this Pan and not Apollo, and I think it really is Pan if you look at his ears. Muirden was also an accomplished illustrator, and one of her works is here, the illustration for the book Pastels and Silhouettes by Mabel Holmes Parsons of 1921, which is, we have a copy in the Oregon collection. We're now going to explore other parts of this building, and we'll revisit the bowsing room later.
In 1937, if we were to exit this room, we would actually be walking into a corridor. There needs to be a corridor here. And on the wall,
on the south side of this corridor, were three ornamental gates. In the model of the 1990s, this wall was removed and the gates were moved to a new location. The gates, crafted by iron, were designed by Orion B. Dawson, or O.B. Dawson. Before settling into a career as a blacksmith, Dawson was a student at UO in 1929 as a music student, and he actually sang opera in Los Angeles, according to him. He did not always personally design the works that his studio manufactured. And among creations associated with Dawson are Dad's Gates, the Howfield Gates, the ironwork at Timberline Lodge, and most of the ornamental ironwork in this library, including, of course, the sets of doors at the two entrances. Perhaps his finest work, though, are the gates of the corridor dedicated to former President Arnold Bennett Hall, entitled The Tree of Life. And here we see the corridor is looking, this would be in here, the circulation area. This is looking toward an exit. It's hard to wrap your mind around this orientation of these gates at that time. Hall was president of the university from 1926 through 1932, a very tough time to be president. And he died in 1930. He had to resign because of illness, and he died in 1936. These words from Hall, which are quoted on the plaques that were adjacent to the gates and had been moved, reflect the attitude of the time. Respect for the homely virtues, a genuine and noble sense of chivalry, and a reverence for the things that are holy. These should be nourished and cultivated until they become the established traditions of the campus, for only out of such an environment can come the noblest and best in character and ideals. So we're going to walk next through here to look at the circulation area, which was quite grand and large at that time, and you see the desk over here. I think Laura worked at that desk. We're now going to go upstairs by way of this west stairwell. We're on the landing. We'll see a giant inscription. The one inscription is authored by Frederick Young, professor of social sciences, and it's entitled The Mission of the University. And the other is a text from Luella Clay Carson, literature professor. I believe she was Dean of Women. And this is entitled Opportunity for the Youth of Oregon. So as you proceeded up the stairs, you would be instructed and enculturated. These Olin canvas works were designed by Noland B. Zane, a professor of art at UO from 1921 to 1944, and author of many articles on aesthetics. According to Zane, these murals symbolize a truthful message for the students to understand. They're done in the manner of medieval manuscripts. They combine decorative dignity with messages of immediate and lasting. Zane is highly regarded as an illustrator, artist of murals throughout campus, and his illustrations can be seen in books such as The Scenic Treasure House of Oregon, which was published in 1941. So we're going to go from the stairwell on to the Paulson Reading Room, as it's known today. And look at this. And this is how it appeared in around 1937-8. It was called the Upper Division Reading Room. And the east and west focal points were these very large triptychs carved out of cedar. They were designed by Art Clough, who came to Eugene in 1935. And this is Clough over here. To work at the Eugene Vocational School. And this school thrived during the Depression because a contingent of Civilian Conservation Corps in Camp in Eugene took classes at this school. Clough was created by the PWA to create the wooden murals in 1934, even before the library funding was secured. And one of the panels was even exhibited at the State Fair in the fall of 1934 and generated quite a lot of interest. Oh, that's the clip. Each work is approximately 9 by 9 feet. And in general, the top scenes represent the youth of Oregon engaged happily in work under the cathedral arches of nature. And below are a total of 18 vignettes which depict life in the Depression. The rest triptych works are entitled Halcyon Days at the Foot of Mount Jefferson, Trails in the Shadow of Mount Hood, and Below the Spires of Three-Fingered Jack. And on the east side, we have road building crew below Mount Washington, construction below Three Sisters, and a pack train below Mount Tilson. Examples of the bottom panels are next. Here we see a campfire scene, men keeping warm. This is smoke. And somebody's cooking something. Here we have a domestic scene, a nice cat. And here's a scene of revelry with people happily dancing. Clough would later become head of design at Lane Community College, and Professor Kenneth O'Connell is currently undertaking an inventory of his work. We now leave this reading room to go downstairs, and on our way, we notice through the glass doors, that there's an enclosure here. And here we are introduced to Louise Utter Pritchard. Louise Utter moved with her family from Washington, Eugene, in the early 1930s. She took art classes but never graduated. In 1936, she married WPA artist and UO graduate Thomas Pritchard. The roofs on the east and west wings of the library, I think this is clever, originally had sculptures, and they were intentionally designed and called balconies. We see up here a little fawn and doe. And for these balconies, Pritchard carved a doe and fawn and a cougar and cub. And these works were very popular in the day and great photo ops. Here's the cougar and cub on the cover of the old Oregon, and this something with the doe and fawn on the balcony. The cougar and cub has entirely disappeared. No one knows what happened to it, and I don't know if anyone, very few people knew it existed, apparently. So let me know if you find out. We know where the doe is, and it's in the niche in the south reading room. Pritchard also designed other works on campus, including the plaque at the journalism building, the Pan figures at the Museum of Art. Her husband got a job at Western Washington College, and at the same time, artist Clifford Steele was there. Some of you may not know Clifford Steele, but he became a very famous modern painter. And while they were there, Steele painted a very beautiful portrait of Louise. We head downstairs now, and we meet the Rundquist brothers. Here's the 1918 track team with Albert Rundquist. And here's his brother, Arthur. The Rundquist brothers were Portland artists, both graduates of UO. They were contemporaries of Brownell Fraser. And they were hired by the WPA to paint murals in the stairwell niches. The murals represent the cultural evolution of man. The West mural conveys the development of the sciences, and this is the West one. And the East one, the development of the arts. Each mural
has 8 panels which tell the story of the evolution of different disciplines. You notice the bottom figures. The science figure is in a position in which he will rise erect to become a thinking being.
And the artistic figure is faced the other way, looking up in aspiration and inspiration. These panels are interesting. At the top of each, a cohort of students at UO is matched with individuals who have reached the pinnacle of their disciplines. And so in this panel of the sciences, we see Einstein, Madame Curie, Edison with the light, Marconi. And in the arts, we see the students at work over here with Mighty Oregon and Dee Dee in the background. And we see their professional contemporaries, Sarah Bernhardt, Caruso, Bernard Shaw, These figures represent technological entertainment. And the painter is Orozco. It would be a great library or research assignment for someone to ponder why the Rundquist chose Orozco. And there is an answer to that. They were actually social activists, associated somewhat with the Communist Party. This is an example of Arthur's work called The Homesteaders, and this is actually in the Portland Art Museum. And on YouTube, you can find a curator from the museum giving a wonderful explanation of why she likes this work. The Rundquists were interesting in that they lived together throughout their entire lives. They shared a studio together. Sometimes they worked on the same pieces and they exhibited together. They were close friends with Harry Wentz, who was the influential head of the Portland Museum's art school. And for 15 years, they lived with Wentz at Neocani, where they created some of their best-known work, which are Scenes of the Oregon Coast. You can find Rundquist art in the museum here as well. Both Albert and Arthur died the same year in 1971. We're now going to go outside and through the lobby. This dimly lit lobby is, in my mind, one of the finest interiors on this campus. And in it we have Napoleon, gray marble, black and gold marble from Italy, terrazzo tile floor, bronze with Art Deco Depression era designs, a roof that is made of gold leaf with a green patina. And through here you can see the Minnesota Casota stone that's used throughout the interior. And as we go outside, we encounter a light fixture by Frederick C. Baker, who did all of the light fixtures for the light design for the 1937 building. Baker was one of the major lighting designers of the Pacific Northwest. And his works include fixtures for OSU, the Pittock Mansion, Central Library in Portland. And here's an example of the Bank of California in Portland. In 1986, an anonymous donor gave $1 million to AAA to create an endowed chair named after Baker, and it was the largest university gift of that kind up to that date. As we look around outside, we can see the landscape designed by Fred Cuthbert. By the way, most of the images I'm using were from the Oregana or Old Oregon, or their originals that were in special collections. And this is from an Oregana. Fred Cuthbert was a professor of landscape architecture. Here we see him with students. He designed not only the campus landscape at that time, and here we see his plans for the Memorial Quadrangle, from which night libraries, portico, and fountains would cascade out. He also designed sites throughout Eugene, such as Altenbaker Park, for which an amphitheater is named after him. As we look up at the facade, we see how Lawrence's drawings became reality. Here we see the parapet with classical themes, the squirrel motif that was also used at the earlier museum, and sketches of heads that would be part of a frieze, and the names of disciplines. These objects were created in cast stone by the Ernest Thomas Cast Stone Company in Portland. Lawrence originally wanted terracotta, but at that time it was too expensive. Cast stone, the Thomas Company thrived from 1910 and worked on until 1959, but by that time it had to close because decoration entirely went out of fashion in favor of sleeker, more modernist designs. But most of the stonework you might see in Portland that's not terracotta was designed by the Ernest Thomas Company, as well as stonework throughout this campus and OSU. The decorative program of the facade was determined by a committee in early 1935. And the committee decided that 7 stone plaques would identify as many fields of knowledge, and that the biblical inscription, "You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free," would be split between the 2 entrance portals. They decided that there would be 5 key figures among the heads, and beings of lesser importance would be populate the rest of the 15. And so we have a total of 15 heads that are duplicated to make a total of 41 throughout the library. And these heads are Thomas Aquinas, Aristotle, John Locke, Thucydides, Buddha, Jesus Christ, Michelangelo, Beethoven, Leonardo, Newton, Darwin, Jefferson, Oliver Wendell Holmes, Shakespeare, and Dante. It was in late 1935 that artist Edna Dunberg and Louise Pritchard were assigned to design the heads. Louise, we've met. Edna moved to Eugene with her family from Iowa in 1929, took courses at UO with the aim of completing a high school degree. She quickly became established as a respected artist. While the heads are sometimes described as stone carvings, they're actually figures molded in clay and shaped. And from this clay, a plaster model was made, which was in turn used to create a mold from which the cast stone was created. And so in a crude way, you could think of cast stone as poured concrete. In February 1936, Dunbury experienced severe back pain in lifting one of the heads, and subsequent prolonged medical visits revealed that she suffered from spinal tuberculosis. And she died in July 1936 after working on the heads for only 5 months. Louise Pritchard carried the project to completion. Our tour concludes in this room, which has had an interesting history over the past 75 years. In 1948, a decision was made in order to address severe space problems to move the browsing room to the new student union that was being built. And so in 1950, the furnishings in this room were moved to the browsing room, reproduced in the Earl Memorial Union. The 3 rugs went upstairs, as did these panels. From 1966 to 1990, this room was walled and partitioned to make office space and classrooms. And for years, it supported the library librarianship program.
While the South Addition was being constructed, this space was used for temporary offices and storage. In 1993, the Friends of the Library funded the reconstruction of this space, and the furnishings that still existed in the EMU and elsewhere were returned. Draperies and furniture disappeared at some point in time. Upon leaving this room today, notice the plaque to the right of the door, which honors one of the library's friends. In 1939, this room was dedicated to Adelaide Church and was Church was a local benefactor and ardent library supporter. She was married to Campbell Church. And Campbell Church was the son of Susan Campbell. The use of the names Campbells is confusing there. from her first marriage. Susan Campbell, of course, would marry Prince Lucian Campbell. And so Campbell Church was Prince Lucian Campbell's stepson. When Adelaide died, Campbell Church gave family home Treetops to you both. And Treetops, of course, is the home of the Chancellor. The Church family is an example of the many individuals whose contributions have sustained this library and the university. In the 1937 Library Journal article, Matthew Douglas wrote proudly of the new library, and his matter-of-fact assessment of the building is worth repeating. Altogether, the feeling is that the university received a good deal for the money invested, and much pride and satisfaction is being taken in it.
Yes. Well, so the gates that cover that hallway are on the outside of the browsing room now, and the two gates that were on the edges are still there. They've slightly reconfigured, but you can see the original gates on either side by the turnstiles.
So that's that is the real location.
They were in a little bit farther. There was a big wall, and there were three openings. And of course, in 37, there wasn't detection gates, and they weren't turnstiles. You could float in freely. But then the turnstiles were added to those openings later. And we used to, before this last renovation, close and lock all of the gates and put big chains and padlocks on them to close in.
I think once you learn about the gates and how they used to look, it's kind of disturbing when you walk out now and see all kinds of stuff in front of them.
I don't know. But they don't have the same effect as they originally did. Is there any questions or discussions? Anybody? Yes.
Is the designation of browsing room just because originally it was meant for people to come and browse books?
Browsing room, according to
this plan, was the center portion here, actually. And then there were two collections divided by these extensions. Of a browsing room for recreational reading started at Dartmouth. But it's interesting, the idea, I think, is kind of being revived here with what we're doing to the South Reading Room.
A popular reading collection, which is not a new idea.
There was nowhere in Knight that public presentations could be given prior to 1990? This kind of event room?
Was it
room 133, which is room 148 now, which where Learning Services staff sit, was the classroom. So there was that teaching space. Richard will remember teaching in that space. And so there's original casework in there. And I don't know if it would have been used for public presentations as much, but to my knowledge, that was the only big sort of room like that.
Yeah, it appears that the browsing room twin in the EMU was used somewhat for that purpose. But I think the idea was the EMU would just serve that purpose generally, not the library. It was a big building at that time.
Do you know which room it is in the EMU that was the browsing room?
Yeah, it still exists. It's the Nils International Center. Okay. If you walk in there, you can see.
It looks just like that. Yeah, it looks like a room.
Yeah. Now on the web there are actually pictures of it too.
Yes.
But I walked in there and looked around to see the cougar was there. But yeah, they actually used as much as they could the same materials. So the stone
fireplace thing is
yeah.
there. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's very strange when you think about it.
I can't believe these carpets are that old.
They're very exactly. Yes.
Wow.
And we saw the picture they had fringe on, I guess that disappeared. I think they were, Nancy, I think there was some great effort to have them clean once there before they moved back in here.
Oh, yes. And they are cleaned by, professionally cleaned by the others, at least once a year.
Oh, yeah.
So is there any, like, photographic evidence of these fireplaces wherever, stoked up and crackling?
Are they real fireplaces in the chimney, or?
They are. I don't recall. They might be. They are real. And they were actually boarded up during when it was repurposed at one time. Oh, incidentally, these panels apparently were where this vent is, the screen. So I don't know if this is new or not, but you can see in the pictures that they are kind of awkward where they are. They were really up at the top. Yes, Tom?
At this fireplace at the east end, you see the sliding panels to the left? They don't slide anymore because they're screwed shut. But if you were to open them, you'd see a hoist that would go down to the basement to haul up firewood.
Oh.
Can we ever build a fire there now?
Sure.
Or we could?
Yes, sir.
Well, this has done a wonderful job, and you really only touched on a third of the building, so I hope you feel challenged enough to do the other two thirds.
Part one. There's certainly more to learn. When I talk to special collections about the Cougar and whatnot, Normandy showed me a room on the third floor which has a beautiful door by Dawson with a peacock on it. What is the
name of it? Brooks.
Starts with a B.
Brooks.
Brooks. Oh, yeah. Oh, there's Linda. It's very good. I've never seen that before. So, and I've never seen it written about before, actually. This part's not finished.
So there's the 37 building, and I know there was an addition like around 1990, something like that. So was another addition in between?
Yeah, there were two more in between. Yeah. It was a 1950 and then
57.
It was filled in the center, and then around the sides, and then to the back and around the sides again. So
that's what I mean by it.
Yeah. Well, some of these were just stacks, aren't they? It was only 1990 that he came, I guess.
Well, the 1960-ish edition was, I think, what references and a lot of what collection services. The low ceiling part. That was,
yeah. When was the big staircase, though? What edition was that one?
The 90.
The 90. So there's a great picture of the original undergraduate reading room, which is where it's 101 or the new classroom. And so there's a picture of that room. It's an original configuration, and it was the undergraduate reading room. There's rows and rows and rows of students sitting in there. And it's on the wall in the reading room, so you can go look at it. It was part of the 1% for art.
Plan, like,